his gates with thanksgiving, enter his courts with praise. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, enter his courts with praise. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, enter his courts with praise. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, enter his courts with praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Enter its gates with thanksgiving, enter his courts with praise. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, enter his courts with praise.
Are we live yet? Good morning, Facebook Live and Abundant Life Faith Fellowship. I'm so glad that you're here today. My name is Pastor Dale, and Elder Steve Brown is a senior pastor here, and we're just so glad that you are here today, and we want to welcome you once more. Everyone say hallelujah. Everyone say hallelujah. Is anyone glad to be in the house of the Lord? If you're glad to be in the house of the Lord, just give the Lord a hand clap. Just give the Lord a hand clap. Amen? Amen. Yes, everybody stand up and say hallelujah. Let's praise the Lord today. I want to praise him.
Just wanna praise it forever.
wanna praise you forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Oh, oh, blessing and glory and honor, for they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus. This praise, come on, forever, and what? Forever and ever for all you've done, oh, for me, oh, Lord, it's glory, for they all belong to you. Just pray forever, forever and ever for all you've done for me. Come on, y'all. Blessing and glory and honor, they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus. Want to praise forever and ever and ever for all you've done for me. Blessing and glory and honor, for they all belong to you. Thank you, Jesus. 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 For blessing me. Everybody say hallelujah. Everyone say hallelujah. Everyone say hallelujah. Say hallelujah like you mean it. Say hallelujah like you mean it. Say blessing me. Say bless. Just say it again. Come on, like you mean it. Close your eyes and say bless. Let's do it again. One more time. Come on, do this on this side. Say. Now watch this. Let's do it again on this side. Don't come here. Let's say. Oh, we got to wrap it up right now. Oh, Lord, I feel the Lord here. Say. Oh, come on now. Oh, let's do it. Watch this. Say. Heirs to me. Come on again. Come on. Oh, yes. Yeah. No matter where I go, you see blessing. No matter where I go, I see the blessings. Oh, yes. How many know the Lord is good? And he's good what? The Lord is good what? Even when we don't feel like saying it, we need to say, God is what? He is good all the time. Amen. I want to introduce Sister Carol Taylor. Give her a hand clap. Thank you. The song that we promised to give you from last week. He knows my name. He knows my name. Yes, he knows my name. Yes, he knows my name. Your presence, I am made new. Say, everybody say this.
Thank you, Jesus, for knowing my name, for knowing my name, for knowing my name.
Go ahead. Go ahead. Come on.
Thank you, Jesus, for knowing my name, for knowing my name, for knowing my name.
Anybody know that? Come on, y'all. Boy, I see some worshipers out there ready. Come on, watch this.
Thank you, Jesus. Know my name, know my name, know my name.
Somebody help me out. Come on, y'all. Come on, come on. Say it now. Watch this. Come on. All right now.
Thank you, Jesus. Know my name, know my name, know my name. You never leave me or forsake me, but I know. Thank you, Jesus. Know my name. Knowing my name, knowing my name.
Awesome.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Oh, I just want to thank you, Lord. I know that you've been so good.
Lord. Lord. Give the Lord a hand clap. Give the Lord a hand clap. Give him a hand clap. Sister Kathy, you have the Mother's Day dance, and I wanna invite Brother Todd to come up as they do their Mother's Day dance for the mothers.
Thank you, Jesus. Mercies and all. Oh, yeah. Oh, mercies and
isn't God's mercy everlasting? His mercy endure forever, doesn't it? So in the Isle of Wonder, without further ado, I want to invite our elder, Senior Steve Brown, to come up and a few words. I just thank God for him. Give him a hand clap. Thank him for all he does. Thank God, amen.
One of the things I like to do first, if you are a first-time visitor or you've never received a copy of this book I wrote called Live Your Best Life Now, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand, and if one of the ushers would give them one, amen. When it comes to living your best life for God, you don't have to wait to next week or next month or next year. You can begin now. And this book will give you some ABC building blocks to think about and to consider when it comes to living life in its fullest. So hold your hand high, ushers, quickly, if you would give them one. We have a special guest, a friend here that is going to come and share something about mothers. Dee Thomas, if you'll come.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. I'm so full this morning. I want to share something with you, and it's not going to take long. Have a heart of a mother to others. What does that really mean? That means you embrace people, you care about people, you do for others as if they were your own child. This world needs so many heart hugs. This world needs so much compassion and empathy. And because the word mother is there, men, please do not get it twisted. A heart of a mother is the heart of Christ. So let us all hug and care. I'm so deeply wounded by what's going on in India. And if I had arms long enough, strong enough, I would want to hug the entire world, wipe tears from the eyes of those who feel that there is no one who is listening, no one who cares. God cares. Jesus cares. So we have to care. Thank you.
This series that we recently started is called Everyday Friends. So it's a series about relationships. It's a series about friendship. And my wife, Marion, is getting ready. She's going to come and she's going to share something about commitment. But before she comes, she's going to kind of focus on commitment in the marriage relationship, but commitment is a very broad subject. Commitment amongst friends, employees and employers, church members, church leaders, and mothers, fathers, children. The story goes on and on and on. There's something powerful and important about commitment in the eyes and hearts of God. Another day with more time, we could take an ABC look at this idea of what it means to be committed to one another as friends. My wife, Miriam.
Praise the Lord, everyone. So what I want you to think about this morning, this is a commitment statement. And I'm using the letters of the word committed to see the importance of how we commit ourselves to one another in marriages, in friendships, or whatever type of relationship we're talking about. Commitment is important. So this is the committed confession. C is because we are committed to one another, we will continue. Say continue. In our relationship. We will not be shaken by circumstances, but we will have stick-to-itiveness. That's what it takes to continue. The next letter is O. We will obey the word of God. In doing this, we are building a solid relationship with God and our mate, or whatever relationship we're talking about. It's very important for us to obey. Obeying the word is the answer to many, many problems. The next letter is M. We are merciful toward one another, as God is toward us. We will always have a forgiving spirit. The next one is M again. Our lives are similar to mahogany, wood. We are strong, but easy to work with. We are strong enough to face the tests and trials that come our way, yet we are flexible enough to be workable in relationships. We will always keep the interests for one another alive in our marriage. Let that man know you're interested in him, and let that woman know you're interested in her. That's important. The next one is T. T. We are tenacious in our commitment. We refuse to let anybody or anything come between us. We're tenacious. Now we have another T. Our reactions will always be tactful when interacting with each other. Hey, remember that when you're real excited about something or angry about something, we will always, say always, be tactful. We will not treat other people better than we treat our mate or whoever we're having a relationship with. We entrust ourselves to each other, meaning we totally give ourselves mind and body because we love each other. We will not abuse this gift. The last letter is D. We are dedicated to God first. God first. We are dedicated to each other. Therefore, our marriage reflects the love that Christ has for the body of Christ. We're a living example of Christ and his blood. Thank you for listening. And I'm happy to be committed to this man. We've been married for 53 years now. Praise the Lord.
So at this time, I'm going to ask Pastor Dale to come, and he and his wife, Carla, are going to share the word of the Lord with us.
Everyone say hallelujah and say amen. I just want to just invite my wife, come on up, Carla. You might want to take your mask off. So just want to just invite her. Just wanted to tell her how much I love her in front of all of you. Just thank you, Carla, for just being with me and tolerating me, you know, for all these years, you know, 19 years, you know. And I just thank God. It's nothing like having a God gift in your life, you know. And I just wanted to tell her publicly, would you marry me again?
I think so.
Always wanted to do that. But God bless you. Without further ado, Carla's going to teach, and we're going to be teaching on intimacy today, and she'll tell you the rest, okay? God bless you. Go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, Dale. Isn't he just marvelous? He just did everything today, right? He gets up, he opens it up, he sings, he'll sing, he'll dance, he'll tell jokes, he'll pretty much do anything. He'll act, he can do it all. But thank you. In the absence of Pastor Boniface, thank you for leading our service today, and I appreciate you as well. You know, our anniversary is in June, but you know, one thing I've learned, you just don't take people for granted. And every June, he'll tell you, every June 14th, I'll look at him and I'll say, you want to go another year? You want to do this another year? I don't assume, oh yeah, we're going to be here forever. We're going to do this forever. It's just my way of respecting the relationship. And I say, you sure? And so when he says, all right, we're going to be together forever, I'm like, let's just take it 1 year at a time, right? Just respect that relationship, and you don't take each other for granted, right? So, as it's already been said, we are in a series on relationships, and we have been given the pleasure of opening up this series talking about marital or romantic relationships. And so last week we talked about communication, and I addressed the women, and Dale addressed the men, and today we're going to switch it up a little bit. I hope I got some men out there I can talk to. Crickets. Oh, there they are. Come on. Come on. Back me up now. Come on. All right. So, I will be gearing most of my comments toward the men about women. So, I think it's going to be really good. We're going to have to put our seatbelts on for some parts of it, but I think we'll survive. So, the scripture that we're coming from, the context is going to be 1 Corinthians 7:33, and it says, but a married man is concerned about the affairs of this world, how he can please his wife. So that's what we'll be talking about. How can you please your wife, men? Can I get an amen from the men? All right. Oh, you are there. There's testosterone in the house. Wonderful. Thank you. So last week I gave the women an assignment, and that was to put some money in their relational accounts by building you up and giving you some compliments on a daily basis. How many of you got that, men? Amen. I hear a few amens. I see a hand over here. All right. Did they do their assignment? Amen. I guess that's what you better say, huh? Better not embarrass them in front of everybody. If they didn't, they still have an opportunity to do so. Because we're talking about how you build up your relationship and how you make it strong. And as I stated earlier, you can never take it for granted. You can't think because you've been together so many years, it's all right, it's good. How many of you know people that have been together 35 years and divorced? Right? People do get divorced at any stage. There is no safe stage. There is no after the first 5 years, after the first years, after the first 10. At any stage, the marriage can fall apart. It just can. And actually, when you stay together a long time, you have more opportunity to build up stuff. Resentment and hurt and unforgiveness and stuff that happened that I ain't never forgotten, you never apologized for, and I'm tired of it and I can't take it no more. So sometimes the very thought, the fact that you are together so long and you have built up so much stuff, that can be a threat. That's why you constantly want to build and you want to add to the relationship and you want to build good things into the relationship to kind of offset the bad. So what is it? We're going to be talking about intimacy today. Intimacy is defined as the mutual vulnerability and openness and sharing. It is often present in close, loving relationships such as marriages and friendships. The term is often used to refer to sexual interactions, but it does not have to be sexual. It doesn't have to be. In fact, it's not just beneficial, it's essential to overall well-being and contains mental, emotional, spiritual, and physical components. So intimacy is essential for every human's well-being. And basically it means that somebody knows you, loves you, cares for you, knows your faults and flaws, and still accepts you. And we all need that. Doesn't matter if you're in a relationship with a significant other or not. We all need to be known and loved for who we are. We all need to be accepted. And people who don't feel known often are lonely. They will complain of being lonely. They don't feel loved. They don't feel accepted and known at their deepest parts. So we all need it. We're specifically talking about relationships today and romantic relationships and marriages, so that's where the rest of this is going to be geared toward. So, men, are you ready? Amen. Ladies, are you ready? You're going to back me up if I'm saying something you agree with? Yeah. Okay, I need you. I need you out there. So, my intent was to read a passage from the book, How We Love by Mylan and Kay Yerkovich, but unfortunately, I left the book at home, so I can't read the passage, but that's okay. I'll just kind of give you a summary. So there's a particular story that they tell, and it's about a couple, Al and Tamara. And it pretty much goes like this. They have been married for 15 years, and Tamara is complaining to her husband about the marriage. She wants things to be better. She wants to do things like go to museums and go to concerts. She wants to talk. She wants to spend time together. She wants to share ideas and dream. And he's just not interested in any of that, right? So for years, she goes on about how she wants to be closer to him. She wants to talk more to him. And he pretty much ignores her and blows her off. Well, there is a cafe that Tamara often stops at to have morning coffee before she goes to work. And it's situated along the freeway, so there are other people who stop and have coffee at this same shop. And there's a man who happens to stop there as well. And so, as it turns out, on certain days, they will sit there and have coffee and share together. And guess what they share? Hopes and dreams and books and poetry and movies, and they become closer. So eventually, Tamara falls for this woman and falls for this man and announces to her husband that she's going to leave him. She's found someone else. Now, that happens. And it's unfortunate, but it does happen. So, what happened in that relationship? He ignored her. She had some needs, and she was speaking them, and maybe he didn't hear them, but there were needs that she had that were not met. There are four parts to intimacy. When we're talking about intimacy, there are four types of intimacy that we're talking about. Emotional is the first one. That's affirming, caring, validating, mutual sharing of feelings, joys, fears, memories, etc. So men, when we're talking about being emotionally intimate with your wife, we're talking about sharing ideas and feelings and hopes and dreams. And can she do that, men? Is she able to talk to you about her fears? Do you listen to her? Right? Am I right, ladies? All right, back me up if I'm right. Do you listen to her? Does she feel safe? Does she know that you are going to listen and not try to fix her? Thank you. Come on now, you got to back me up. All right, so mental intellectual intimacy. That's meaningful conversation, debating and challenging each other, sharing values and interests, discussions about movies, books, and plays. The same thing that Tamara was talking about. Philosophies, humor. Do you laugh together? Men, do you laugh with your wives? Yes. Do you tell jokes? Yes, right, often. We laugh often, pretty much every day. Is it okay for you to laugh at yourselves? To laugh at each other, is that okay? Is it okay for you to do that? Do you find that? Do you have that in your marriage? Good. Can you go to a good movie and talk about it afterwards? Oh, yeah. Yeah. Do you share aspirations and hopes and dreams? Is there mutual respect for her thoughts? Does she feel respected? Does she feel like you're not trying to fix her and make her be what you want her to be? Is it safe to disagree in your household, men? Is it safe? Can she disagree with you? Can she challenge you? Yeah? Are you able to do that, women? Are you able to challenge him and he not get his ego bruised? Yes? All right. So is there mutual respect? Is it safe to disagree? She wants to grow. She wants to expand her knowledge. She's interested in the world. And again, I'm not saying everybody's the same, but if you married a bright woman, she wants to know, she wants to explore. She wants to get out. She wants to grow as a human being. She wants to be mentally stimulated, right? She wants intellectual intimacy. And then the spiritual component. Is there praying together? You know, I'll hear a lot of women say that, you know, they want their husbands to be spiritual leaders. Do you pray together? Do you lead the devotionals? Do you respect each other's beliefs? Just because you're Christians doesn't mean that you agree, right? Is that okay in your house? Do you have to agree on every doctrine? Do you have to agree on every scripture? No. Can you have a debate? Can you talk about that and say, I think this is what the Bible is saying? And is that okay? Do you get preached at in your house? If you're married to a pastor or a preacher-like person, right? Are they always going to lecture you and tell you the way it is and get into their preacher voice? Oh, my goodness. Nobody wants that. Nobody don't want to lay next to the pastor. They just don't. Even if you're married to the pastor, right, there's a time and place for everything, right? Come on now. Yeah. Yes. Well, I know it's getting a little quiet. I don't know how to take it, but that's all right. I'm going to keep pushing through. Do you inspire each other? And do you articulate God's blessings? Do you say, you know what, I think the Lord came through for me today? That's intimacy, men. That's what she wants. She wants emotional intimacy. She wants mental and intellectual intimacy. She wants spiritual closeness. And if you ignore all that and think you're going to get to the physical, you got another thing coming. It ain't happening. Because you got to have the friendship first, right? You got to have the friendship. You got to build the foundation. You got to like each other. You got to share interest. You got to have mutual respect. And if that ain't happening, the physical, right, it's not going to happen. All right, so let's talk about the physical. That's all the hugging and kissing and cuddling and holding hands and all that eventually leads to sexual intimacy. But as I said before, if nothing else is happening, that's going to be awfully cold. Yeah. You know, I hear a lot of women say this, and again, I don't want to generalize. I don't want to say all men are like this and all women are like that. I don't want to say that. But often for a woman, it's these first three that are very important. And I've heard couples in my office say, and I've heard the woman say to the husband's chagrin, I just want, you know, a hug or I just like to cuddle and I'd be fine with that. Don't matter to me if we ever do anything else again. And that's shocking to men. They don't like hearing that, right? But you got to know how she's wired and what's important to her. In this area, men and women, this area of physical intimacy, are fundamentally different. All right, so let me put the graph up there, please. The next one. All right, so this is, I hope you can see this, but perhaps you can. I will read it for you. So if you look at the top, and this is just my little visual of the way I see men and women. So if you see men at the top, and I'm talking about physical intimacy, right? So you see men up there, and they just have the thought, okay, the thought of being together in that particular way. You know what I mean, right? Are you with me? You know what I'm talking about. All right. And so the thought, and then you'll see a line, and then you'll see it's just a straight line and then ready. That's kind of the way I see it, right? For most men, and I know at a certain age things change. I know it's not that easy. But for a lot of men, it don't take much. Just think, let's go. And for her, it's not that simple. Look at that line. For her, there's the thought. And you see that line going everywhere? Yeah, that's where she is. And she may get down there to, okay, I think I'm ready. Right? But look at all the twists and turns she goes through. So men, listen up. This is what a lot of times, if you're not getting nowhere, this is what's going on. I'm tired. Have you heard that one? Hello? Men, have you heard that? Have you heard that? I'm tired. I got to work in the morning. The kids are awake. My house is a mess. I don't feel like taking no shower. I got in an argument with my mother today. I'm just not in the mood. All these things are going off in her head. She is not a one-shot person. She's got all these things that she's thinking of. And God forbid that you have got, if you said something to her that upset her, she ain't forgot that, right? You see, he said that thing to me last week, and then here you gonna tap me on my shoulder, roll over, feeling breathing on your neck? No. You ain't apologized. You ain't even thought to apologize to that thing you said to me last week, and you think I'm going, you got another thing coming, right? Well, as for men, a lot of the times, they can put that stuff away. It's time to take care of business. We can take care of business. But that's not always the case. So you need to understand, men, how she's wired. And I'm sure if you've been married for a while, you know that. All right, so let's look at quickly the Song of Solomon. Let's take a look at that. All right, now hang on here. Now, this is the Bible, and I didn't write this, okay? This is the Song of Solomon, chapter 4, verses 12 through 16. Now, the Song of Solomon is a book of poems or songs back and forth between a lover and Solomon and his bride-to-be. In this particular chapter, this is the wedding night. So there's this anticipation that's been building up between the two of them. And then they come to the wedding day. Verse 12. Now he says, a garden locked is my sister. Now listen, you gotta read into what's being said, okay? So pay attention, men. A garden locked is my sister, my bride. A spring locked, a fountain sealed. Your shoots are an orchid of pomegranates with all choicest fruits, henna with nard, nard and saffron, calamus and cinnamon, with all trees of frankincense, myrrh and aloes, with all choice spices, a garden fountain, a well of living water, and flowing streams from Lebanon. That's him. He's describing her, every part of her. She says, awake, O north winds, O come, O south wind, blow upon my garden and let its spices flow. All right, you got me? You understand? All right. This young woman describes herself as the rose of Sharon and the lily of the valley. This is where we get the descriptions of Jesus. So, when's the last time, men, you were invited into the garden? Yeah. When's the last time? That is the culmination of the love relationship. If you have not been invited in, or if you've rushed through and you haven't been able to enjoy yourself or enjoy this part of your relationship, then it's time to check out the relationship. Check out the other four areas or the other three areas. Check out the mental and emotional areas. Check out the spiritual areas of your relationship. Are those things intact? Is the garden locked? Then what's going on, men? Did you say something that was disrespectful? Did you hurt her feelings? Are you not going anywhere? Has your life become boring? Do you not take her anywhere? Have you not gone on any dates? Can I get some backup women? Amen. Have you done anything for her lately? So, if you haven't had it, if this is not happening for you, then check the other areas. So, in conclusion, men, here's your assignment. Plan a date for your wife and act as if you were on your first date, right? Treat her as if you didn't know her. Go pick her up and take her out. I don't mean stand next to her in the house and say, are you ready to go? I mean, get your car ready, buy some flowers, go pick her up, dress up, take her out, and act as if you don't know her. Get to know her. Hear her with new ears and see her with fresh eyes. See if maybe you might be able to take a stroll through the garden. All right? All right. Thank you so much. Come on up, Dale.
Everybody say amen. Give her a hand clap. Start talking about intimacy or sexual stuff in the church, it gets real quiet and people are like, ooh, don't talk about that. But it's a real deal. And we need to talk about that, especially for married couples. Amen? The other day, I saw on the news, Carl and I saw on the news, it was a car accident in Maryland. I don't know if you heard about it on Route 90. What happening was a car ended up like on the leaning on the side of the bridge, and a girl in a car seat ejected out into the water. She's down in the water, and her car seat flips over. There's a man named Jonathan, without even thinking, just runs and jumps over the bridge to save her. He saves her. He's a hero. Everybody say Jonathan is a hero. Now, what caught my attention about this, even if he, at the sake of risking his life, he decided he was going to go over there and save that young lady. And by the way, his daughter was looking on thinking, oh my God, am I going to lose my daddy? Now, the point is here, some of our marriages are in trouble, going through stuff. They're actually drowning. Are you willing to do all that it takes to save your marriage from drowning? Amen? So last week I spoke to men on what kind of a love they should be practicing towards their wives. This week, I'm going to be talking about intimacy and what men are looking for and why he needs to be respected. And I'm going to be talking to the ladies, okay? Is that okay, ladies? And just like Carl said, men, if you agree, let me know, okay? Women, I will promise to be gentle, okay? I promise, all right? Amen. Now, as we see some of the secular world Hollywood view of sex and intimacy is very twisted and perverted. And as born-again believers, we cannot use them as a model for our marriage. Can you agree to that? The only one that we can use as a model for our marriage is Yahweh, the living God, amen, who came down here in the flesh as Yeshua HaMashiach, Christ Jesus, walked this earth and gave great instructions on how a marriage should be. And I'm thankful for that. How about you? So what is the true meaning of intimacy? It says this usually denotes mutual vulnerability, openness, and sharing. It is often present in close, say loving, relationships, such as a marriage or friendship. And the term is often sometimes used to refer to sexual interaction, but intimacy does not always have to be sexual, okay? Intimacy is a relationship, is a feeling of being close and emotionally connected and supported. It means being able to share a whole range of thoughts, feelings, and experiences that we have as human beings. Now let's open the discussion up about intimacy in sex in marriage, okay? Is it be okay? Just say sex. Everybody say sex. It ain't a bad word. It's Facebook ain't a bad word. You know why? Because God created it. Amen? Say, our Father created sex. And the married people say, yeah. Married people say, yeah. Amen. You know I said married people. So what does this look like? And why is this so important? To make this subject more comfortable for some of the wives who may not necessarily like talking about sex and intimacy, what I want to do is let's see what God's word says about it. Now, sex was created to be a unique experience, amen, to bind husband and wife together in what the Bible calls a one flesh unity, according to Matthew 19 and 6. It says, so they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let no man separate. So if God puts you together, let no man separate, amen? Since God invented sex, he gets to set the parameters for the use, and he makes parameters clear in Hebrews 13 and 4 and 1 Corinthians 6 and 18. Sex was designed for marriage, period. And any sex outside of those boundaries is sin. Let me say it again. Sex was designed for marriage, period. And anything outside of those boundaries is sin. Amen. All the believers say amen. 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 Now the Bible states sex is designed for a married man and woman. In Hebrews 13 and 4, marriage is to be held in honor among all. And the marriage bed is to be undefiled, for fornicators and adulterers God will judge. Did you hear that? Those who practice fornication and adultery, God will judge. Amen. And let me just talk a little bit, just a little bit about this. Young people or those who are unmarried, it is best to do it God's way. Do you hear me? It is best to save yourself for the wife or the husband that God has for you. Amen. Kind of quiet in here. I know you're thinking. 1 Corinthians 6 and 18. Flee immorality. Every other sin that a man commits is outside the body, but the immoral man sins against his own body. Marital sex is between a man, let me get this clear and understanding, is between a man and a woman, not two men and not two women. Simple biology. It makes it obvious that a male and a female bodies were designed to fit together in a way that the same sexual physiology cannot. Do you hear that? So we will buy a man and woman just fit together. The way God did this is so beautiful. Amen? Now, because the sexual drive is so powerful, the Bible does encourage marriage in order to avoid sexual immorality. Now the Bible encourages marital sex should be mutual and frequent. Please go to the next. I think you guys are not on my PowerPoints. Keep going. Right there. So the Bible encourages marriage between male and female. Now concerning the things about which you wrote, it is good for a man not to touch a woman, but because of immoralities, each man is to have his own wife and each woman to have her own husband. Amen? Go to the next slide. Marital sex should be mutual and frequent. Ladies and men, but I'm talking to the ladies today. It should be mutual and frequent. Stop depriving each other. This is what Corinthians said. The Bible talks about this. It says, stop depriving one another except by agreement for a time, so that you may devote yourselves to prayer and come together again, so that Satan will not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. Now, wives, one way to drive your husband into the arms of another woman is that you keep depriving him of sex and intimacy. That will drive him away. But you both must come together mutually and frequent. Now, that all depends on what you look at as mutual and frequent, but it has to happen. If it doesn't happen, Satan will get in. He will get into that marriage. He will get into that marriage. I've seen it. Talked to many people. Intimacy and sex is very important in a marriage. How many know that? How many know that? I only see a few hands come up here. If you're not married, one day you hope you be with. Do you know how important it is, intimacy in marriage and sex? It is important. Marital sex is to be mutual and frequent so that the husband and wife are not tempted to commit adultery. Husbands and wives belong to one another. Don't you know that? 1 Corinthians 7:4 says, a wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. And likewise, the husband does not have authority over his own body, but the wife does. The husband should fulfill his marital duties to his wife. Amen? And likewise, the wife to her husband. When we understand that our bodies are not our own, that they've been pledged to our spouses, we should shut the door on any other thoughts, loaning them to someone else. Marriage was designed by God as a picture of a covenant relationship that he wants with us. Covenant marriage. is a vow to God. Do you want me to say it again? Covenant marriage, a promise marriage, is a vow to God. You made this to God first before you made it to one another. Amen? 2 Corinthians 11 and 2, it says, a thing that has me upset is that I care about you so much. This is the passion of God burning inside me. I promise your hand in marriage to Christ, present you as a pure virgin to her husband. Now, God places great importance on human sexuality between marital sex. It is the most intimate relationship two human beings can have. This is the most intimate relationship that two human beings can have, and that's through sex and intimacy. It is also a picture of the intimacy of God created us to enjoy with him. Ain't that good? Did you hear that? In marital sex, there is the giving over of the body. And in our spiritual relationship with God, we are to present our bodies as living sacrifices. Now, enjoying intimacy with God, with your spouse. Keep going. Thank you. You're there. Romans 12, 1 and 2. Therefore, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. And do not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, so that you may prove what the will of God is, and that which is good and acceptable and perfect. If we continue with this old thinking about intimacy and sex, of what the world sees it, we will never get it right. We will bring that baggage and that trash into our marriages, born-again believers I'm speaking to. Amen? We should have a new thought, born-again believers. We should have a new thinking on what sex and intimacy is. We should be enjoying that with our spouses. Amen? What if, let me share with you, what if it wasn't all about me, but it was all about your husband, or all about your wife? You considered their feelings instead of all about yourself. What if that would happen? If you can just consider your wife, men, and I'm talking to men real quick, and you said, baby, I understand. I hear what you're going through. You know, it might take me a while, but I understand. And ladies, what if you just said, sweetie, hey, I respect you and I compliment you and I thank you for what you do. What if you did that a lot and said that a lot? Men, ladies, men really need to hear this. Probably more than women. But men need to feel good about themselves. And when God puts a spouse in his life, that spouse has an obligation to say things to help him. Because you are his helpmeet. Amen? Now, the sexual act is a consummation of the covenant made between a man and a woman. Covenants were always consumed with the shedding of blood, according to Exodus 24 and 8. So Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant, which the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words. And blood is to shed when virginity is lost. When God made his covenant with us, the blood of Christ was shed. How many know that? So it's actually a blood covenant. Did you realize that? Once that marriage is consummated, there is blood. It's a blood covenant between the husband and wife. That's why sex and intimacy should not be casual, going out and doing it with everybody. Because some people don't realize that it is more spiritual than natural. Sex is more spiritual than natural. Whoever you go out there and spread yourself with, you're tying yourself to that person. It's called a soul tie. And you bring that into your marriage. That's why I encourage, if you're not doing it, don't do it. If you are doing it and you want to get married, stop it. Stop it. If you've given your whole life and your heart to Christ, stop fornication and adultery and all this stuff that you're doing. Ask God to help you. Because you want to save yourself for your wife. You want to save yourself for your husband. Amen? I know it might be, I know this might not be a popular subject that some people don't like to hear, but it's need to be said. Amen? Marriage considered an eternal covenant. Amen? Now the God of peace who brought us from the dead, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, even Jesus our Lord. Marital sex is more than a means of procreation and safe outlet for our sexual drives. It is holy to God because it symbolizes the pure soul intimacy. He wants to share with us. How many know, and I want you to hear this, that when you are having or making love with your spouse, that God is in the midst. Anybody heard that before? Nope, you ain't never heard that prayer before. Some of you might be. But God is in the midst sharing in your intimate relationship. That's how it gets better. Remember, God designed it. God is the one that wants to keep you together, rejuvenate your intimate lives. He wants to rejuvenate it, make it better, enhance it. You just have to submit and be willing to do it. Amen? Now, let me get to the nitty-gritty here. Wives, what does intimacy mean to your husbands? 1 Corinthians, it says, but I want you to be free from concern. One who is unmarried is concerned about the things of the Lord, but he may please the Lord. But one who is married is concerned about the things of the world, but he may please his wife. And his interests are divided. Now, the woman who is unmarried and the virgin is concerned about the things of the Lord, and she may be holy both in body and spirit. But the one who is married is concerned about the things of the world, how she may please her husband. Intimacy, it means to us as husbands is that we deeply know you while also feel deeply known by our beautiful wives. Amen? Let me say that again. We want to just know you, wives. Try to understand you, wives. And we want you to know us as well. Every human craves this kind of intimacy, amen? And through at times, it may seem more difficult for men to express it, and that does not mean they don't need it or want it. Men have a hard time expressing what they want. How many can agree to that, man? Can you agree to that sometime? It's hard to express to our wives. That's why it takes practice. Amen? Dear wives, one thing that can cause havoc and chaos in a marriage is the lack of intimacy that a wife gives to her husband. Now, the lack of intimacy can cause support, understanding, loneliness, and anger issues between a couple. And my wife kind of mentioned this. So what I want to read some of the things that a husband goes through when they're not getting frequent and mutual sex and intimacy with their wives. Some things they can be going through, they can have low self-esteem. They can have trust issues. Experience episodes of anger. Activity, avoid physical contact, have trouble forming or committing to close relationships, have a history of unstable relationships, be unable to share feelings or express emotions, and have an insatiable sexual desire going north. This is what happens, wives, when a man is being deprived of this God-given sex and intimacy that's supposed to be between you and him. Amen? Now assume that the two of you are having sex and that you are sexually happy. A husband who seems happy is overall a good sign. Do you agree to that? Ladies, do you agree to that? Men who are not satisfied tend to be very moody, huffy, distant, and they may also just seem just overall depressed. It does, ladies, have an effect on us husbands. Ladies, can you agree? Who, wives, can you agree? Ladies, if with an amen, do you think the husbands kind of act a little funny when they ain't, when they're not really? Amen. No, thank you, Sister Felina. Come on, come on, ladies. Don't the men act a little off-kiltered a little bit, you know? Yeah, because two becoming one, you are one. Men really, really need it. I'm serious. They need it. But they need the intimate part of you, not the wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. No, they need intimacy, togetherness, knowing that they're loved, knowing that you know them and that you hear them. Men, don't you like to be heard? And women, don't you like to be talk? Women, don't you like to talk? So women, and we appreciate you talking, but sometimes kind of listen to what we say. Amen? Now, what does husbands need from their husband is a meaningful, growing relationship. At the end of the day, men want a relationship where they can feel good about themselves and where they feel like they are with someone who is mature, being able to communicate, and compromise are just some aspects of mature relationships. Wives, your husbands appreciate respect coming from you and having a partner who works together with them. Amen? I believe most of us who are husbands trying to grow and improve on our daily journey with our wives believe she wants to feel secure both emotionally and financially. We also believe you are looking for honesty in your husband. We realize you do not like a dishonesty. And the only way that you can be part of your husband's life is through honesty, no matter what happens, okay? Lastly, 14 ways you can build intimacy with your husband and enhance your relationship. You all ready? Ladies, I actually got this on your notes. Here's a 14 ways. Share experiences. Everybody repeat it. Say, share experiences. Share experiences. Take part in meaningful connection, deepening activities with your partner. Amen. You think that's Sister Carol? Is that real? Sister Carol, I love Sister Carol. She said, hey, me and my hun, we getting ready to go. We getting ready to go out on a trip or something. I love Sister Carol. She's like, we getting ready to go. You know, that's what you're supposed to do. Enjoy going out, sharing experiences, having fun with your partner. Express yourself. Amen? Express yourself, ladies. Give compliments. Flirt with your husband and dress up for him. Wives, dress up for your husband. Flirt with your husband. If you don't flirt with your husband and dress up for him, somebody else is going to be trying to do it. Flirt with him. Be, when y'all first met, remember when you first met? Be that lady when you first met. And husbands, learn to be romantic, man. Learn to talk to your lady. I mean, like, put me a little music on, some soft music. Hey, girl. Wow. You look so good to me tonight. Yeah. We going out tonight? Like that dress and them shoes, girl. Oh, boy, you always mess around saying that. But all I know, and I'm so glad that you are with me, and thank you for being my girl. Ladies, do you like that? Yeah. And men, you should like saying it. Write your own poem down. Get a little music for your woman. I like to mess with Carla. You know, do a little crazy stuff. You know, she laughs. It's just fun. It's just really fun Being married is so fun, I tell you. Yeah, it has its ups and downs. But God designed it to be fun in intimate relationships. Amen? So let me read this real quick and I'll be done. Love yourself, ladies. Pamper yourselves and pamper him. Provide support. Develop safe and effective communication. Really listen to him and respectful responses. So you, when you listen to him, have a respectful response. Amen? Do at least three things a day for your own pleasure. It's important that you don't have to always depend on him to satisfy yourself. Amen? Receive gifts, compliments, and help graciously. When your man gives you something, ladies, you should, oh, thank you, honey. Thank you, sweetie. Give him a kiss on the jaw. Do you know how that goes a long way? Men eat it up. If you're not doing it, try it. Respect the man that you choose. Express gratitude three times daily and strive to be vulnerable. In conclusion, a marriage needs intimacy to survive. Though there are many types of intimacy, physical intimacy often enhances a marriage. Though it is not necessary for all people and all couples, most marriages cannot function in a healthy way without emotional intimacy. Amen? And this last scripture, Carla was, she read, but this is the lady, and just a little music, and we're going to end it. A little music. Yeah, so, yeah, nice man. And the lady, this is what in the Song of Solomon it says, when my king lover lay down beside me, my fragrance filled the room. Now, this is what the lady is saying. His head resting between my breasts, and the head of my lover was a sachet of sweet myrrh. My beloved is a bouquet of wildflowers picked just for me from the fields of Engedi. On my day, dear friend, oh, my dear friend, you're so beautiful, and your eyes so beautiful. Now she's saying this like doves. And you, my dear lover, you're so handsome. She tells him, and she said, and you, my dear lover, you're so handsome. Ladies, how many times you tell your husband he handsome? Oh, so Sister Carol say that. But a show of merit, do you tell your husband he's handsome? Even if he ain't handsome, make him believe he's handsome. Come on, ladies. Make him believe it. You're so handsome, and the bed we share is like a forest glen. We enjoy a canopy of cedars enclosed by cypress, fragrant and green. Now that's in the Bible. Ain't that something? Amen. So I want to close, and we're going to do a closing song. I just want to say, all those out there in Facebook land or whoever here in Abundant Life Faith Fellowship, if you have never had a chance to have a personal relationship with Christ, I want to invite you in this prayer that I'm going to lead you into, okay? I want you to say, Father, say, Lord, say, Jesus, forgive me for my past, my present, and my future sins. Come in my life and fill me with your precious spirit. Have your way, Lord, in my life. And teach me, Lord, your ways, that I might be able to teach others your ways. So thank you, Lord, today for saving my soul and making me whole. In the name that is above all names, we thank you, Jesus. Amen. And Lord, bless every married couple, Lord, Father, right now, that will call and I presented and serve today, Lord, that they will be able to take something away from this, Lord. And Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for being glorified in the heavens and also in the earth, Lord. We thank you for all that you continue to do for us, Lord, for you are good and your mercies endure forever. We thank you so much. In the name that's above all names, we thank you, Lord. Thank God. Amen. Let's do, I want to praise you. That was so beautiful, man. Everybody stand up. And we're going to sing this last song, and we are dismissed. Amen. Did you enjoy that? Hope you enjoyed it. Got a little something out of it. I want to thank my wife again. Thank you, Carla. Thanks, Sister Carol Taylor. Just thank her for coming and help minister today.